I will try to present how sociology as a science, as a kind of a discipline, may be used for studies of public policies, because it's a place when this applied sociology is in development. My institute was established in the last part of the communist regime in the 70s of the 20th century. In that time, it was called as Institute of Social Prevention and Resocialization. The name was not important. It was interdisciplinary institution. When the former leader, the first leader was Adam Podgórecki. And it was the professor who tried to develop what he called as a social techniques. And social techniques means something, establish a kind of rules, principles, how to control somehow the society. When he was thrown away from Poland because he was anti-communist oriented, he tried to develop this concept in Canada and UK, calling social engineering. And the social engineering is a name how this concept, this approach, is recognized in Anglo-Saxon literature. In the beginning of the transition period, in 1990, the group of sociologists from that institute decided to create a new institute called Institute of Applied Social Sciences, just with the idea to follow the transition time and to study and analyze new social problems just connected with this systemic change. And I studied in the Institute of Social Prevention and Resocialization. I finished my study in 1990 and it was just the first one who studied in one institute and started to work in the new one. So all my academic career is connected with this institute from the very beginning. So this is now nearly 30 years. To be involved in applied social sciences, it means that you have to make some kind of bridge between theory and practice, and you have to be involved somehow in, let me say, decision maker processes, implementation of public programs, and all these things. These are 4 points that show how I was involved during my job career. All this time I worked at the university, and always I did something else just as a way to combine both fields. So first of all, for 10 years I was a civil servant working for the parliament. I was secretary to the committee, Senate committee, the higher chamber, working on social affairs. Then, for the next decade, I was responsible for a social policy program in one of the leading Polish think tanks, so it was kind of an independent research and analysis institute. Then, I worked as an expert of what we called the Laboratory of Social Innovation. It was a group of independent experts, but cooperating closely with the Ministry of Social Policy, how to organize some kind of change, especially in the social welfare system. And last 2.5 years, I cooperated with the Chancellery of the President of Poland. First, I was an expert. For half a year, I even the advisor of the President in the field of social affairs. And these are that's my own remarks, 5 principles, how to shape social reality using your sociological knowledge and not become a politician. So, how it is possible? Is it possible? My answer is yes. And if you would like to follow this road, what you have to take in account? So, first of all, probably the most important is being able to distinguish between what is called as policies and as politics. In Polish language, such distinction does not exist. Both are called as polityka. In Ukrainian language, how it is? Do you have one term or two terms?
The same.
The same. The politics is a game for power. So politicians, parties are just one of them is in ruling, other are in the opposition, and they try to change the places. And everything what they try to do is just to win, not to be replaced, and all these things. But of course, in the same time, these persons, this group of people, as decision makers, have to shape our reality using different public policy programs. And this is the level of the policies. So, in fact, both are, it's a combination of both. But if you are able to distinguish these two, let me say, aspects, and try to be active in one, not being active in the second, it is possible, but you have to be aware where is the border and not take more steps forward. If you are allowed to do, but you become a politician. That's the case. So because of that, if you try, you cannot be any kind of a cynical, that if you try to distinguish this policy and politics, you cannot be against politicians. Because you have to try to understand them. You are rational being involved in policies, but they have also their own rationality, which is different one, but it's also a kind of rationality. So you have to understand. Not because if you don't want to understand, you just accuse or something like that, you just will be thrown away. Second, trying to make public as much as of your research work as possible. You are involved in some analysis, in some advisors, in some expertise, but when you are involved in the research, you do some research, you have to do everything what is possible to make this data published. So being open to use by other researchers, but other decision makers. It is very important because for two reasons. First of all, because the knowledge, the science is something that you try to do together with others, not alone, not staying separate somewhere and doing something you only know what's going on. No, you would like to share with your colleagues. And secondly, you are paid by the government, by the ministry, so there are public resources. If there are public resources, it has to be open to public, somehow. So that is try to do. If there is research, please make any kind of agreements of, to have a chance to make it published. Maybe not at once, maybe after some time, but please try to do it. If you try to do it, you are definitely close to the policy than politics. The third point, being able to distinguish between applied and engaged. This our Adam Podgórecki is very aware of this. To be applied is that you are, if you are engaged, it means that you support something very strongly, that it is right, not wrong, something like that. It has to be done because you are become much close to the ideology. And from ideology to politics is just one very small step. Mm-hmm. If you are much more applied oriented, it means that you may serve to some extent to different decision makers. Because you have some rationale to say, and you would like to share whoever wants to take it. It is the idea. Of course, for some decision makers are closer to you, some are not so much close, but if you are asked, you try to do your job, because you have something to share. So this is connected with this point number four, being open-minded, able to cooperate with different public institutions and decision makers. It means that if you serve for someone, you may serve also for others. It is not forbidden. You will say it openly. First time currently, I do a service for my president. And I do it as a head of the country. And and I try to say, yes, the head of the country needs some kind of a professional support given also from the from such a person as I am. But it doesn't mean that I am a member of any party or I am affiliated with the party. No, I said it's a more organized in this way. The point number 5. Never make statements, opinions, especially publicly, on the matters you are not enough competent in. Never. If you are a specialist in social policy, please do not say what has to be done with the forests, for instance, because it's an environmental policy. You are not a specialist in. You may have some opinions as a citizen, but it is not your professional knowledge. So please don't be involved in this. It is especially important when you try to be active in media. Media is a special kind of the world when they try to ask experts to make their opinions, but most of media would like to hear something special. That they organize something to cut the trees or not to cut the trees. And they wanted to, if you are a specialist, you are enough strong to say, what do you really think? If you are not interested, please don't publish. But it is my opinion. If you are not a specialist, you start the game that they will give you a chance to be popular and you try to give what they want. And after something, you become much more savory or something like that than the real expert. So if you want to be specialist in policies, please don't do that. That's my experience. If you are involved in public policies, we may distinguish 3 aspects or 3 elements or 3 stages. First, it is assistant in programming. Each public program has to be prepared by someone. And you may be involved in such a process of preparation with your expert knowledge. Second, each program has to be implemented. And you may be asked to follow this process of implementation. How to do it or how things are going on. It is an analysis of implementation. And the third stage, you may be asked to evaluate the results. What really happened after the implementation? Is it a successful program or not? All 3 aspects can be seen as a field when applied sociology may be used. First aspect, this programming, it's away from goals to tools. So the politician, the decision maker, is empowered to say what has to be done, and you try to give how to make it work. What has to be done in practice to achieve such a goal? So, for instance, corruption. If the politician is not corrupted yet, he may start to say how to solve this problem. He needs anyone to tell him what to really do. Second, implementation of programs. Applied social sociology makes a kind of a rise an aspect of legitimization. Politician, decision makers, majority of them don't think in this way. Well, they try that if the program is correct, is well prepared, it must be working. It is not the truth. Because implementing something is just to try to shape the behavior of the people. And the people, to some extent, are free what to do with your program. And so, it is a problem of legitimization that what to do, how to behave, to receive a real support from the people, from special institutions or just from citizens. Because when the rule is not approved, it doesn't work, in fact. People try to do something with it, but not what you wanted. And sociological knowledge is crucial here. How to legitimize among the people. And the third aspect, this legitimization is a very much sociological oriented term. It comes from Max Weber, one of the most heroes in sociology. The third point, assessment of results. Of course, not only sociologists are involved in evaluation activities, but sociology is specially used for such as side effects, unsuspected effects, unintentional effects, opposite effects, that things are never happens as we would like to have. That the results are always not the same as the plans. And that you are open to see not only what you wanted to achieve, but to study all other changes. And sometimes some side effects are more important than others. Side effects may be negative, may be positive. But you have to be open to realize what's really going on, what really happened. And let me give you an example. Something that I was involved during the last 20 years in a kind of the research analysis. This systemic change. So the communist collapsed. In Poland it happened in 1989. We start to be on the road toward democracy, market economy and civil society. And I would like to present you significant distinction between two frames, how to analyze systemic change. In the foreign literature to the subject, especially given by Americans, British and others, they use the term to call what's going on in such countries as Poland and others as a transition. Transition is a road from one point to another. So transition is just to replace the old system by the new system. You had the institution from the old system, so if you want to change the system, you have to resolve all the past and build something, everything new. And of course the idea is just to transplant something from there, because they have democracy, so just do the same as they already have. Our sociologists who were involved in studying this systemic change try to use another term, transformation. Transformation, it means not to replace something by something, but rather to reshape. That is a process of change. It's not just something disappeared and something appeared.
It's not just copy.
Yes, yes. It is just you have to reshape, and it's a process that has its own logic. And these are Polish sociologists who coined this term transformation. It start become used in our part of Europe as a kind of a little bit different approach than theory of transition. And if you study such transformation or transition, you have to distinguish the logic of this process, that we've done something rationally, some ideological condition, and some external structure of influence, for instance, what other countries try to shape you and all these things. I have no time to discuss it more. I would like to say some kind of my shift in developing this approach. What I proposed, and it has been, let me say, accepted. It is quoted many times in other texts, that I developed the concept of waves of reforms. That when the system is changing, especially in the social sphere analysis, because I'm involved in social policy, there are special periods where the changes are accumulated. It never happens one by one. It is just so this is a concept of waves, like in the sea, that something happens, then there is a break, and then another one. So the analysis is focused on such peaks of reforming activities. And it gives you a chance to compare such peaks. First to distinguish them, and then to compare each to another. And to see some similarities and some differences. You are able also to distinguish these two aspects, politics and policies, and policy. Because politics is connected with the parliamentary term. New government is created, they come with their own agenda and try to do something in opposite to those what was done by the former government, for instance. And sometimes things are really opposite, sometimes it only look like. It differs. So you just start to study what are the real links between politics and policies. And we may distinguish in Poland during the last 25 years such four peaks, four waves of social reforms, and each of them were different from other. First peak was at the beginning of transformation. It was just a shock therapy of the economy system, and social programs were used to keep support of the people for this reform, so just to pay some kind of a social cost of such reforms. Then, between 1997 and 2001 was the second wave, when there was idea what to do with the social sphere itself. So, what kind of model of social policy you would like to provide, and the decision makers gave two different answers in one time. They wanted to decentralize, so to give much more power to the local governments than to the central government, and at the same time to push some market forces into the public sphere, so to marketize social programs. And it was a mishmash of both. And this was done in this, so at the beginning those authors of these reforms called four great reforms, and this adjective great does not exist more because it was criticized later on for this lack of cohesion. The third wave was done when we joined the European Union. It was done in a way that we have to follow some priorities of the European Union to be a member of. And we have to reshape our social policy just to reach European standards. It was the third wave of the reform. And the fourth wave is just going on nowadays, when after about 1.5 decades of domination of neoliberal approach, very market oriented, now there is much more space for the social orientation. And this is done under the fourth wave of the reforms. And how to use the sociological knowledge in such analysis of the reforms. First of all, this number one, the policies cannot be boiled down to the politics level. You have to take into account this political game. It's important element, but you have to study about the merits what is the program, what is really, what is the merit, what is the content of it, not how it is played, let me say. And you try to compare this merit aspects. Secondly, you are, let me say, free from this political battle. You may see similarities where the politicians see diversity, and you may see the diversity when the politicians try that it is completely the same, something like that. You are free from their game. They play their game, and you see something from your own perspective, which is to some extent objective. What's more? You try to see that those peaks are important, but the years of breaks are also important. You need to reset, you need to rest after the period of extensive engagement. So those periods are also, to some extent, functional. From politician point of view, it looks different because they always have to be active. Whenever, if they have anything rational to propose or not, they have to be active. The societies from our part of the world, those societies who tried to escape from communism to the democracy and went through this process of transformation, are currently much more flexible than, for example, Western societies, which are much more stable, cohesion, and aware of any radical reforms. But, on the other hand, there are some limits for reform. For example, in Poland, sometimes this changing the direction results in a, let me say, very different solutions. For instance, retirement age. When the communists collapsed, the retirement age of the women was 60 and of the men was 65. But the government was very afraid of the result of shock therapy introducing unemployment. Because during the communists, unemployment does not exist, it was hidden unemployment. But so the reform was just to make the hidden the open, that's right. But what people would say, so that was the idea to give every retirement privileges so the women may have a chance to become retired in the age of 55 and the men in the age of 60, so 5 years earlier. Because whoever has a pension is not unemployed by definition. So they push the retirement age 5 years lower. Then, after a few years of when people just become used to live in a new reality, the government said, unemployment is a problem, but you have to do something with it. We are not to pay off. So they just stop this early retirement and just come back to this 60 and 65. But then the government said that, oh, there are some demographical problems. We become much more elderly society, so we have to pick up the retirement age. And there was also the, let me say, how to say this, equal rights for men and women. So they fixed the date, the retirement age at 67 to everyone. And what's more, they decided to push children to school 1 year earlier, so not in the age of 7, but in the age of 6. It means that you start to work 1 year earlier. So for the women, the law was changed from the 55 till 67 plus 1. 13 years, it's a huge difference. You never is allowed to do such radical changes It's stupidity. It cannot work. And that is why people as a whole oppose this last 67 very openly. And that is why it was once more have been changed to 60 plus 65, so as it was in the beginning. So many changes and no result, the same at the end. That's some kind of a game without enough rationality. Let me say that also, if you try to be active in such kind of analysis, you may also, and this is what I try to explain publicly in Poland, somehow, that maybe some reforms are different in each of the stages, but it doesn't mean that one reform is correct and the other is not correct. Because maybe this reform was functional at the stage number 2, and this one is functional at the stage number 3. So maybe it is a kind of rationality as a whole process, even if you do some changes. And it is a way in which you try to organize the public discourse on the reforms, which is something more than only the political game. And of course, decision makers also need such kind of a knowledge. Even if they make some kind of public statement, they are not use this knowledge, but they ask for it. They need this because it has to be done in a rational way. So that is why there is a space for such an engagement, so for such an involvement of social scientists representative under what is called as a place of sociology. I have another example I presented for today, but because of, for some reasons the time was is shorter than it had, I will stop at this point. So thank you very much.
Thank you for your extremely insightful and penetrating presentation and analysis. Do you have any time for questions? Or you have?
No, we have. We have about 10 minutes or so.
Excellent. I was privileged to have the discussion with you a couple of days ago. And you said a very important thing that in Poland, social sciences have been involved into producing reform, into formulating public policy. Could you give advice to us, the Ukrainian sociologists, how to make us visible to politicians and policymakers? How should we offer our ideas, our services, our knowledge, and how to bridge this gap between politics, policy making, and the world of academia? Because right now, unfortunately, there is huge, I would say, a terrible gap between social sciences and policy making. Policy is done very chaotically and with very little academic advice.
First of all, the scientist has to build a kind of an environment that we know something that you don't know and what you really need. And we cannot be, let me say, and we need some space for the cooperation. And we are ready to cooperate in a way that we would not just to critique you, we would like to make some advice, but please, you have also accept a kind of a freedom of ourselves. It's just that we would like to do our job, not just to become politicians. Of course, any such a game needs both sides. If one side wants to play and another doesn't want, there's no such a play. But maybe you have to try to do it on a much more local level. In Poland, when we start our road from communism, And we had such thing as a round table. It was a compromise given by some people from opposition and the last communist government. And because of that, the democratic regime was limited on a central level. So that is why so many people decided, okay, it's a kind of a compromise that's making working, but we would like to build our country on the municipal level as a real new reality. And it was the first real systemic reform where was just to establish self-government on the municipality level, which is to a significant extent independent from the central government and maybe organized from the very beginning without this, let me say, community heritage. So it is one of the ways just to be involved in some things which are going on the municipality level, in a city, in a district, not necessarily in the ministry. Of course, such things is also, you have also to be asked to be there. If you are rejected, there is no possibility. The third way is just to fix on a good education. That if you educate people with a real knowledge, they will come someday to the ministry, to the major office, somewhere, and try to make a space for the scientists. And maybe the third one is the most probable to implement. You just have to wait. But if you give any kind of a professional knowledge to students, then they will do with this knowledge something in their jobs. For instance, for many years I was involved in the university in preparing, I was a manager of the specialization of people, preparing people to work, to do some professional paid job in non-profit sector, in non-governmental organizations. And after 10 years of such involvement, I had students in all the third sector infrastructure. I could go anywhere and I was welcomed because I knew someone who really attended my courses. And if such a person evaluated me as a someone who is a real expert, I was listening, I was on, that is the power. So of course it makes more years, but it is a way.
Thank you. Any more questions? We've got students doing masters in conflict regulation, and in fact, this is perhaps the small step towards bridging this gap between policymaking and academia, because this program was launched at the initiative of the Ministry for Temporary Occupied Territories of Ukraine. So maybe you guys have questions, comments, because you will have to be involved into policy making pretty soon. Yeah. Please use your mic.
Unfortunately, I missed the major part of your lecture. Maybe you talked about this, but I would like to ask you if whether there was any case in Polish history when the Polish government tried to implement the new public policy that was absolutely contradictory to the values of the Polish society. Whether there was such a case and how it was solved. Thank you.
The phenomenon of the Polish road to democracy, that at the beginning of our transition there was solidarity movement. It was, let me say, something that produced collapse of the communism in our country. And solidarity movement was by definition very much solidarity oriented. And when we reject the communism and build this kind of, and implement this kind of a shock therapy of the economy, it was very much neoliberal oriented. So very much individualistic. And the paradox was that the solidarity as a movement won, and that solidarity as a value collapsed. And we need about 20 years altogether taking to start to aware that what happened is not what has to be done. That we need much more community-oriented way of shaping public policies. And in my opinion, and also the second, that you are not allowed to organize social sphere in a very economic way, that some are the winners, some are the losers, and that's the life. So those people, when we celebrate the anniversary of 25 years of collapsing communism, all this, let me say, neoliberal part of the politicians try to celebrate it. It's a huge victory. And the people say, sorry, no. And they lost the election. Just in the year of the ceremony, so we lost a lot of such things that the day where launched the victory, and the people say, thank you very much for this victory. You would like to say someone else who is much more, let me say, community-oriented. And that's the case of Poland now. This government makes a lot of mistakes. I do not want to defend him, but this was the real element when the, let me say, elite start to think in one way, and the common people does not just share this idea. But altogether, it was not right. It was, and nowadays even liberals start to think that we cannot be as much individualistic oriented, because we never won once again. We once again with such a problem as it was in the past.
Okay, thank you, Marek. It was extremely interesting. Oh, okay, go ahead.
I just wanted to ask how can you evaluate the strength of some institutional heritage of Soviet governments onto the way how new institutions work.
In my opinion, one of the most important influence of this communist heritage is what we called in Polish language Polska Resortowa. It means that each ministry, each department has its own policy or something like that, and it is separate one from another. It is. It looks like a 15 policies, each not coordinated by another. And what is nowadays, what we try to do is to build what we call as horizontal policies. So it means that there are cross-sectoral or cross-ministerial, just to stop this kind of behavior. It, for instance, came into such a situation that we have a law. We are a country when the law is universal, so every law is for everyone. But in fact, each of the services work on its own law. So social welfare has its own act. And the people, social workers and others, are completely not interested what is written in other laws. Because the only law they just go to is their own law on social welfare. The same is with the employment service. They have their own law, and this is only what is put here is what they want to follow. And the same with other. And what to do with it? It is a problem, and even it makes some kind of results also on the government level, when sometimes Prime Minister is not enough powerful to control the ministries because of this. So nowadays it's a kind of a reshaping. We call this as a new mode of governance or something like that, but try to do this in a different way, but it's very difficult, and it is not easy to implement.
question. How to be a sociologist, to be independent? Because
can you speak up?
There are interests of ordinary people, there are interests of politicians, yes. How to be effective arbiter between them?
No, you cannot be an arbiter. Your independency is based, in my opinion, in two aspects. First, that you are a professional and you try to say, where are the limits of my professionalism? I am not a specialist of everything, I already said about it. Especially on this, this and this, and I will be active only here. And secondly, to be intellectually honest. So to be the independence, it means that you are able to say the same in different situations. And after some years of your activity, you are seen as such a person who is intellectually honest. And this make you some kind of independence. Of course, on the other hand, there is a price to be paid. You are to somehow alone. And you have to accept this. Yes.
Okay, thank you, Professor Rimza.